Good evening. Welcome to our Maundy-Thursday service offered by Monroe Street Church. My name is Elizabeth Rand. I'm one of the pastors serving at Monroe Street, along with Pastor Larry Clark, who is preaching tonight. We are so glad that you are worshiping with us in person and online. Our Holy Week observance will continue tomorrow night with our Good Friday service, which will also be at 7 p.m., and we hope you will join us for that. Now, friends, I invite you to stand as you are able and join me in the call to worship. Come and remember Jesus' last meal with his disciples.
Come to receive that bread and the wine that Christ now offers to us.
Come and remember how Jesus washed his disciples' feet. Our pride and seek the humility to appropriately worship this day.
My brothers and sisters, Christ shows us his love by becoming humble, a humble servant. Let us draw near to God and confess our sin in the truth of his Spirit. Merciful God, we have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength and soul. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We have not loved our neighbors as you have taught us. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
We have not fully received the saving grace of your word and life. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May the Lord have mercy upon you, forgive and heal you by his steadfast love made known to us by the passion, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Thanks be to God.
Hear the witness of the early church as recorded in the words of the 13th chapter of the Gospel according to John. Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know now what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew who was to betray him. "For this reason," he said, "not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, he said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set for you an example that you also should do as I have done to you." After saying this, Jesus was troubled in spirit and declared, "Very truly, I tell you, one of you will betray me. It is the one to whom I give this piece of bread when I have dipped it in the dish." So when he had dipped the piece of bread, he gave it to Judas, son of Simon Iscariot. After he had received the piece of bread, Satan entered into him. Jesus said to him, "Do quickly what you're going to do." And Jesus said to them, "Little children, I am with you only a little longer. Where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Simon Peter said to him, Lord, where are you going? Jesus answered, where I am going, you cannot follow me now, but you will follow afterward. Peter said to him, Lord, why can I not follow you now? I will lay down my life for you. Jesus answered him, will you lay down your life for me? Very truly, I tell you, before the cock crows, you will have denied me 3 times. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Let us pray. On this remembrance of the most holiest of nights, we ask that you would open our hearts to hear a word from you. May your Spirit fill this place and fill us. We ask in Christ's name. Amen. On Sunday, we celebrated Jesus' entry into Jerusalem with palm branches waving and hosannas. In the following days, Jesus was in the temple teaching and being challenged by the religious leaders. Then Jesus withdrew to just be with his closest friends gathered at a meal. John's gospel tells this remarkable and scandalous story of Jesus going around the table, washing the feet of those who had gathered there. This was, in essence, the accumulation of Jesus' teaching about a new world order, a kingdom, if you will, where the greatest are not those in power with wealth and servants, but one in which the most honored are those who serve. What could be a more dramatic illustration of this than the rabbi, the teacher, the one who was proclaimed king on Palm Sunday, getting down on his hands and knees, washing the feet of his followers? Jesus follows this up by saying, "A new commandment I give to you, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You should also love one another." We call this evening Maundy Thursday, derived from the Latin word for mandate or commandment. The commandment to love one another. If nothing else, we should understand that fundamentally Jesus' message was love. Therefore, it is hard to understand how so many people who claim to follow Jesus put so many conditions on people to become a part of their community. It is hard to understand how people who are supposedly about love make so many negative judgments about others. It is hard to understand how people who claim Jesus would put up barriers for others to participate in this meal in which we partake this evening. Pope Francis has been working to break down the walls and barriers, even against the traditions of his own church. Several years ago, Reuters News Service carried the following. Two young women were among 12 of those whose feet Pope Francis washed and kissed at the traditional ceremony in Rome, in a Rome youth prison on Holy Thursday, the first time a pontiff has included females in the rite. The Pope traveled to Casa del Marino prison on Rome's outskirts for the traditional Mass, which commemorates Jesus' gesture of humility toward his apostles the night before he died. The ceremony has been traditionally limited to men because Jesus' apostles were male. The Vatican spokesperson said two of the 12 whose feet were washed were Muslim inmates. While the former cardinal included women in the rite when he was an archbishop of Buenos Aires, it was the first time women had taken part in the papal Holy Thursday ceremony. Taking the ceremony to a youth prison was also the first papal visit, and Francis, who was elected only 2 weeks before, said that he wanted to be closer to those who were suffering All popes in living memory have held the service either at St. Peter's Basilica or the Basilica of St. John in Lateran, which is the Pope's cathedral church in his capacity as Bishop of Rome. In a brief, unscripted homily, the Pope told the young inmates that everyone, including him, had to be in service to others. It is an example of the Lord. He was the most important, but he washed the feet of others. The most important must be in service to others, he said. Pope Francis understands the significance of Jesus' action. Professor Elizabeth Johnson helps us to see how true love can be transformative. She writes, "Jesus' commandment to love one another is not a commandment to feel affection, but a commandment to act in a loving way, even when we would rather do otherwise. Of course, we always fall short of God's perfect love, but that cannot be an excuse to nurse grudges and wallow in unloving behavior. As we are washed by Jesus in God's deep and generous love, our hearts are stretched to love more completely, fully, and unwaveringly. I am reminded of a documentary I saw some years ago on CNN in which the reporter Christiane Amanpour interviewed a woman in Rwanda named Iphigenia. She was from the Tutsi tribe, and during the Rwandan genocide of 1994, her husband and five children were clubbed and hacked to death by a mob of Hutus, including one of her neighbors. The neighbor who had participated in the massacre spent 7 years in prison and then went before a tribal court where he asked for forgiveness for Iphigenia and the whole community. Iphigenia opened her heart and forgave her neighbor. But it does not end there. Iphigenia, a master weaver, also taught her neighbor's wife how to weave baskets. The two became friends and business partners. On the day that Christiane Amanpour was interviewing her, Iphigenia had invited these same neighbors into her home and was serving them dinner. That's right. She was serving dinner to the man who killed her husband and children. When asked how she found it in her heart to forgive, Iphigenia said simply, "I am a Christian, and I pray a lot." This is crazy stuff. Who would do such a thing? Who forgives someone who murders your family? Yet, that is what Jesus is calling us to do, isn't it? He said, "Love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you." Jesus exemplified at what lengths love will go. Jesus washed the feet of Peter, who denied knowing him. He washed the feet of Judas, who would betray him so that he could be crucified. And on the cross, he prayed for his executioners, saying, "Forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing." The call to be Jesus' disciple is to move beyond our selfish desires and our self-centered greed. It is a call to wash feet. It is a call to love our enemies. It is a call to forgive. How can this be possible? It is possible because of the love of God in us through the power of the Holy Spirit. Let your hearts be open to God through the movement of the Holy Spirit. Let Jesus' life and teaching dwell in your hearts. May it be so. Amen. Would you join with me? God is with us. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. From the earth you bring forth bread and create the fruit of the vine. You formed us in your image, delivered us from captivity. You formed us, and you fed us manna in the wilderness, and gave us grapes as evidence of the promised land. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. When we turned aside from your way and abused your gifts, you gave us in him your crowning gift, emptying himself that our joy might be full. He fed the hungry, healed the sick, ate with scorned and forgotten, washed his disciples' feet, and gave a holy meal as a pledge of his abiding presence. By his baptism, by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Christ Jesus, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us, that our lives may proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ was died, Christ is risen.
your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in his final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Children of God, let us pray together. To God, our Creator, our Redeemer, our Sustainer, our Mother, our Father, who is in heaven, holy is your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The bread that we break is a sharing in the body of Christ, whose body we are. The cup of blessing that we bless is a sharing in the life of Christ, poured out for us and poured out through us for the life of the world. Friends, these gifts of God are for the people of God. Come, all is prepared. So we'll invite you to come up to the center aisle and take a piece of, take a wafer, and then go to the station with the cup, and you will be able to take your cup of juice. Let us keep the feast.
Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for the blessing of this evening and the reminder of your great love for us as demonstrated through Jesus' most gracious and humbling act. And then he still offers to us yet this meal, a reminder of his sacrifice on a cross. So we give you thanks, asking your blessing upon us this evening.